Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to our service today. Welcome on behalf of the congregation of St. James United Church. I welcome you on behalf of St. James, on behalf of Reverend Diane Robinson, and myself as staff here at St. James. We are gathered to celebrate the life of Robert Verdun McInnis. So welcome to you here in the sanctuary, here at St. James, and welcome to everyone online. Feel free online to say hello in the comment section. There are little emojis if you want to press them as well to let people know how you're doing, and let us know where you're joining in from. Bob and Joan were regular at church for decades until Joan moved to Pioneer Village. Joan can't be here today, so a shout out to Joan. We love you. We miss you. We send our love to you. If you want an order of service, please go to our webpage, stjamesunitedvirginia.com, and you can download it. There's also a link on the Facebook page. Here are these promises of Scripture from John 14. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house there are many dwelling places. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And when I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and take you to myself, so that where I am, there you may be also. Peace I leave with you, my peace I give unto you. I do not give as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not let them be afraid. And from 1 John 4:16b, God is love, and those who abide in love abide in God, and God abides in them. And so our opening hymn, For the Beauty of the Earth. Part of the COVID restrictions are that we can't sing in the sanctuary, and Don Monk is singing for us today. To open your hearts in prayer. Let us take time now to remember Bob. This is a time to let go of any regrets. Let any tears or sadness be a sign of love. Let us be open to divine peace, God's peace that passes all understanding. I invite you into a time of silence. Restore us and renew us, O God, we pray. Amen. Kirby McInnis is going to share memories today on behalf of the family. So, Kirby.
Thank you. I'd like to say welcome to everyone coming out in these strange times. Shout out to our brother Ken, who's locked down in Ontario right now. Couldn't be here. I know he wanted to be. And two of my kids, Maggie and Callum, who are in Saskatoon because they couldn't be here as well. So it's hard to sum up 89 years in a few minutes, but we're going to try. You all would have known Dad in various capacities. I think everybody knew he was a musician. He loved playing. He was a jazz musician, played in big bands. Some things you might not have known is that Dad consistently beat the odds. Like 89 years was incredible. He was born premature. And in 1932, which was when he was born, being premature wasn't the same as now, right? The odds were really slim that he would have even come out of the hospital, but he did. 6 years later, he got rheumatic fever as a kid. It had actually damaged heart valves, so he lived his entire life with a heart murmur, some damage to his valves from the rheumatic fever as a kid. But he kept going. He worked very hard at keeping himself healthy. Then in his 60s, the valves started to give out, and he had valve replacement surgery to replace the valves because he didn't have much choice at that point. Went with it, came out. The surgeon did a wonderful job. It was great. He had... That was about 24 years ago. After the surgery, we all kind of breathed a sigh of relief, the kids, because we were told that the valves had... every time I talked to Dad, he kind of used a different number, but we had somewhere between about 9 and 13 years life on those valves, and that was 24 years ago. And he had, after he came out, he ticked. It was really funny. And he had arrhythmia. After his surgery, he didn't before, but when they restarted his heart, he had this arrhythmic, weird ticking. And I know my kids used to come and sit on Graham's lap and listen to him tick. It was quite funny. Dad was a handyman and an expert repairman. He had some unconventional ways of repairing things. He was red-green long before red-green even existed, often. He built the family beach cottage with Pop, our father, who we call Pop, back in 1955. He finished our basement at the house at 5 Hanley Crescent, including even spinning the dowels for the banister and everything on his wood lathe. He could repair all kinds of things. Mitchell, when he was little, would break toys and bring them to Papa and say, "Papa, fix," and somehow Papa managed to fix them. If you knew our parents, you probably would have thought, you know, Dad wasn't that talkative, because my mom was the talkative one. But he did like to talk, and he did like to tell stories. A lot of them were related to his days as a pilot, because he had his private pilot's license. He actually wanted to be a commercial pilot, but the heart condition precluded that from happening. So he got his private pilot's license. And he would tell stories. He would take us out to the airport to watch planes take off and land. And Chris, you know where Chris is up in the balcony. Chris developed a love of making models from those days. And in his room back in the day, he had all these models of planes hanging by strings from his ceiling. And he would put them, they were mostly World War II type models, and he put them in battle formations and that kind of thing. And that came from being taken to the airport by Dad. So But he would tell, when he got the chance, he would tell these long, elaborate stories that often had really, really lame punchlines at the end of them. Related to being a pilot quite often. I don't know if my brothers remember the Doink Maker. Do you guys remember that? The story about the Doink Maker? No? Okay. You're stealing my lines, guys. He told this big long story about this thing he made called the Doink Maker, and there's absolutely no way I could tell it again, but at the end of it, you know, with us kids, he'd reel us in, and then we'd be like, and what happened? And I seem to recall it was taken up in the plane and throwing it out, and it hit the ground, and we're like, what happened? And it went doink. And another one about how he had to bail out of his plane one time, and he would tell this long, rambling story about trying to save the plane and everything and all of this, and then he had to bail out, and we're like, were you all right? What happened? And he was like, well, yeah, I was wearing my light fall coat and my spring shoes. And then he told a real story one time that I found both amusing and kind of disgusting about a day when he was a pilot where he took a buddy up who got airsick right as he was coming into land, and he had to try to land the plane with his passenger throwing up all over him. So, from a fashion sense, Dad, he kind of, as he got older, he sort of had this dad uniform where he was in jeans and a collared shirt of some sort, either solid or something checked, usually like this. In his younger days, Dad was often a lot more about comfort when he wasn't working. And he would wear things out and then some, until Mom would finally make him throw them out. He had these polyester pants that, I don't know if they'd been leisure suit or part of a work uniform he'd had or something, but he wore them until they were just about falling apart. The cuffs, they were all bedraggled. So then he cut them off into what he called clam diggers and wore them at the beach, along with this old parody of a Molson Canadian t-shirt that was blue with a gold label, said Molson Ukrainian Schwager Lager on it. And he just loved that. He walked around dressed like that all the time. So he also loved Christmas. I think Dad got more excited than any of us about Christmas. He just, when it was Christmas time, he would act like a bigger kid than most of us. I think a lot of it was that he used it, it was a good reason for him to go buy treats, things that he wouldn't normally buy during the year. Chocolates, of course, because Dad loved chocolates. The Imperial Sharp Cold Pack Cheese, he got us, he would bring that home. That was always a Christmas thing in the house, and I periodically will still go out and buy it when I see it. Cookies, I mean, he loved the baking at Christmas. Dad loved cookies. He would eat cookies all the time. Fortunately, Mom was really good at making cookies, so, you know, they were a really good match in many ways, but that was a really good way. And the once in a while where they would not have cookies on hand for some reason, way back when, Dad would go out to the old Dad's Cookie Factory in White City. If you remember that one, you could buy broken cookies in big bags, and he would buy them. He didn't care the shape that they were. One of Dad's favorite sayings about things was, if you didn't like the way it looked like food, he'd say, it's going to look much worse when it hits your stomach. So he didn't care. He loved Dad's cookies because he dipped them just in his coffee to soften them and eat them. And he liked decorating, hanging our stockings. He built a little fireplace even in the basement for us to hang stockings. And we were putting up the tree. We had this ceramic angel, and it would always be who gets to put up the angel. And Dad would help. Mom hated that angel. It was this ceramic thing. It was, she would go, I'm going to throw that out. It's so ugly. And it was like Bride of Chucky ugly, actually, that thing. It was old, and it came from his family. And Dad was a collector of sorts in that He didn't like to throw things out. Mom used to say that we'd need to buy a second house for all the stuff that he just kept accumulating that he wouldn't throw out. And it was never big, grand things. It would be little things. Because he was a handyman, right, and a lamp would break, he'd cut the cord off, right? Especially valuable cord if it had one of those inline switches on it. You never know when you're going to need that again. So he had all kinds of things like that in the house. He always had a reason for why he would keep them around. But he was also quite sentimental, right? So that angel was a family thing, and that's why he wasn't going to get rid of it. And Mom was never going to throw it out on him either. She talked a lot about that kind of thing, but she would have never done that. One of the family things that he brought in was, he had got it from his dad, I believe, was an old 16mm movie projector that his pop had gotten from somewhere, and a bunch of old movies. And we used to have movie nights as kids, or even movie days on, you know, bad weather days in the Sunday. We'd make popcorn and we'd invite friends over and watch all these old movies that were vintage. Mighty Mouse and Woody Woodpecker cartoons, and I had an old Abbott and Costello and a Laurel and Hardy, Hopalong Cassidy, an old W.C. Fields short from in the days when, before they showed commercials before all the movies, they used to have short features that they would show. It was great fun, and Dad really enjoyed it because Dad really just liked watching anything televised. Mom used to say that he'd watch paint dry if it was televised. So he wasn't much of a cook. He was born in 1932, so he hadn't really. He was pretty typical for his time, I'd say. Eggs and bacon. That was his specialty. If Dad was cooking, we'd have eggs and bacon. He would barbecue. One breakfast treat that he had was, and I ate it this morning, in fact, shredded wheat, the big ones, not the little ones. He would take shredded wheat and put it in a bowl and put hot water over it, and you'd strain it off, and then you put butter and Roger's golden syrup on it. We always had Roger's golden syrup in the house because Mom used it for baking a lot. Way back in the day, you could buy these like paint tins, basically giant things of Roger's syrup. And I was informed recently, because that's how I remember it and that's how I make it, but I was informed recently by my older brothers that it was actually coffee that Dad used, at least on his own. He never put coffee on mine because I was probably a little young at the time. So he would pour coffee over it. And knowing Dad, he would have strained it back into his cup and then drunk the coffee afterward. Because he loved coffee. He loved coffee. It was amazing. He drank it, like, just all the time. And then he gave it up because it was affecting his heart. After his surgery with the arrhythmia and everything, he gave it up. So that was really incredible. And he gave it up mostly because he wanted to be around for Mom. Dad loved dogs. We had five, right? Five, I think. Rex, Igor, Lana, Susie, Ginger, if I got it all right. Rex was the first. I don't really remember Rex. He was kind of before my time. He died when I was a little kid. Lana was this super laid-back Cocker Spaniel, black. She was just laid-back like you would not believe. And Ginger was like a little miniature Irish setter. She was just a mutt, but she looked like a little shrunken Irish setter. And she was the last one because they were getting older, and he just didn't want to have any more dogs at that point. He decided he was old enough, didn't want to have to put one down or have one outlive him at that point because he wasn't sure. So when he wasn't watching TV, Dad actually had lots of hobbies. He did lots of things, and he worked at quite a variety of jobs. And I remember talking to him one time, a long time ago, about all the different jobs he had. And he said that he would get bored, and he'd just want to do something different, and he'd change jobs. So he worked way back for Avis Rental and Canadian Motors. So he was always bringing cars home, and he knew quite a bit about cars, and he taught us a fair bit about cars. And he would take the older boys out, but when they were going to buy a car, and help them inspect it and that kind of thing. And then Carrie got into the car business too, in automotive. And so when I was starting to look for cars, Carrie actually would come with me to look at cars when I was living in Regina. And now they're just so complex that I just take them to a garage because there's just too much to them. But. So he had lots of hobbies, music. Obviously, when he had a yard, gardening. He loved gardening. He had a huge garden at the house on Hanley Crescent. Photography. He went through a spell where he had all kinds of nature photography was a big one. We have all kinds of pictures, nature photography stuff. And then as he got older, he got into carving. So he started carving. He had the carving tools, and he would carve birds like ducks, I think is what he did mostly. So he was, he was either watching TV or he was doing something. And I remember him once talking to Mom about a friend who had retired and had kind of stopped. They retired and stopped doing stuff. And Dad just couldn't comprehend it. And he said jokingly, "He's retired, dear. That means tired twice over." So Dad didn't slow down. Even in his retirement, he had his hobbies and kept going. So he changed jobs a lot. We had all these different jobs. There was kind of lateral moves. We never were really super well off or anything, but we always had enough. He always made sure that we had enough. And thanks to Pop, we had a beach cottage, which is still in the family. My brother Carrie has it now, so that's good. We come down to visit every August long weekend, spend the weekend there. And he was very generous too. When we were cleaning out his place, we found all these pens and calendars and that for all these charitable organizations that he'd given to over the years. It was quite something. And when 6 years ago, I have twins, my oldest boys are twins, and when they were getting their license and were wanting a car, it was about the time that Dad was upgrading his car, and he brought his old Chevy Lumina for the boys to drive. So it was good, because he took care of us. He always made sure we had enough. And like he did, he accumulated all this weird little stuff related to handyman or sentimentality, but that was about it. Because he always said, when at the end of the day, it's not the stuff you have, it's how you're remembered. And I think he succeeded. So thanks, Dad.
Thank you, Kirby. On October 23rd, 2016, Bob and Chris Stevenson and Christine Beer played in church What a Wonderful World by Louis Armstrong. And Chris recorded it. And so today we're going to hear a recording of that. It's recorded in church, and there's some people talking at the beginning, so it's not, crystal clear. And so we thank Chris for this. And before I begin, I just want to read the words. "I see trees of green and red roses too. I see them bloom for me and you, and I think to myself, what a wonderful world. I see skies of blue and clouds of white, the bright, blessed day and dark, sacred night, and I think to myself, what a wonderful world. The colors of the rainbow, so pretty in the sky, are also on the faces of people going by. I see friends shaking hands, saying, how do you do? They're really saying, I love you. I hear babies cry, I watch them grow. They'll learn much more than I'll ever know, and I think to myself, what a wonderful world. Yes, I think to myself, what a wonderful world. So that's Bob with Chris Stevenson on the harmonica and Christine Beer on the piano. We continue with our scripture readings for today. 1 Corinthians 13. If I speak in the tongues of mortals and of angels but do not have love, I am a noisy gong or a clanging cymbal. And if I have all prophetic powers and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have all faith so as to move mountains but do not have love, I am nothing. And if I give away all my possessions and I hand over my body so that I may boast but do not have love, I gain nothing. Love is patient, love is kind, love is not envious, or boastful, or arrogant, or rude. It does not insist on its own way. It is not irritable or resentful. It does not rejoice in wrongdoing, but rejoices in the truth. It bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Love never ends. But for prophecies, they will come to an end. As for tongues, they will cease. As for knowledge, it will come to an end. For we know only in part, and we prophesy only in part, but when the complete comes, the partial will come to an end. When I was a child, I spoke like a child, I thought like a child, I reasoned like a child, and when I became an adult, I put an end to childish ways. For now we see in a mirror dimly, but then we will see face to face. Now I know only in part, then I will know fully, even as I have been fully known. And now, faith, hope, and love abide, these three. And the greatest of these is love. And from 2 Timothy 4, I have fought the good fight, I have finished the race, I have kept the faith. So today is a day of gratitude, and it's a day of tears as we celebrate the life of Bob McInnis. Today we give thanks for this beloved child of God and for all that he taught us. We also give thanks this day for the gift of life itself and for the power of love in our lives. You've heard memories of Bob. We all have our memories, and he leaves a huge legacy in who he was and who he will continue to be for us. I will remember Bob as a man of faith and faithfulness. He and Joan were part of this community of faith for decades. They sang in the choir, and then after leaving the choir, retiring from the choir, they were a familiar sight in the congregation on Sundays in their spot. And then when Joan moved to Pioneer Village, Bob had to change spots. It was too hard to sit there, and he moved to the back pew in the corner. And later, Chris Stevenson sat with him every week and made sure that he got to church each week. But I think Bob's greatest expression of faithfulness was to Joan. It always moves me to tears when I think about how he went every day to see her when she moved to Pioneer. And it was a very hard move for Joan. It was hard for Bob. And Bob did all that he could to help her stay steady. And there were many challenging times for both of them. Bob almost died a few years ago, and I remember visiting him in the hospital and seeing him fight almost breath by breath and heartbeat by heartbeat to regain his health. He was not going to leave Joan. It was hard after that, when he had to cut back on the visiting for the sake of his health. And in these past few weeks in the hospital, Bob fought to hang on for Joan. And if it were up to Bob, well, he'd still be here today, but our bodies can only live so long with the health challenges that he had. Bob was a man of hope. Somehow there was hope. He'd had struggled all his life, like you said, and he still hoped that he would get better. He'd just get that edge so he could keep going, that there was some kind of solution to his medical issues. And I know he was a source of hope to you, listening to you when you had problems and doing his best to help out. And when things got rough, I think it coming to church helped him to get grounded in hope again. And I think a big part of that was the music. We have wonderful musicians here, and the Spirit moves through music to open ourselves up to beauty and possibility and spirit. Bob was a man of love, of deep love for his family. As I said, his love for Joan just shone in his actions, and his character reminds me of some of those qualities listed in 1 Corinthians. And believe me, I don't think Bob was boastful or arrogant or rude. 1 Corinthians is all about the power of love in community. And the word for love in 1 Corinthians is agape. This is the power of unconditional love. This is the love of Jesus for humanity And it is the love that we are invited to share with others in our world. Unconditional love names where there are issues, and it also is judgment-free. Bob loved making music, as you heard, church choir, 49ers, many bands he started and played in over the years. Music brings people together at so many levels. The congregation, folks at Regina Village, the Bandits were some of the places of community and support for him in these later years. And family, friends, our other minister, Reverend Diane Robinson, spent many hours talking with Bob over the years and being a channel of divine love and hope for him. Friends from church called regularly. Band practices were a place of support. And you, his family, supported him and were channels of love to him. Not only was Bob a person of love, but he fought hard in love. I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith really speaks to me of Bob. When Bob went into palliative care, the nurses thought that by his condition, he might not live more than a few hours. I said to myself inside, no, no, no. This is Bob that you're talking about here. He has defied death once and more throughout his years. He's pretty tough. And he managed to last another 36 hours so people could say goodbye. Bob's life among us is finished. And while his life has come to an end, it is the promise of the Christian faith that death is not the end, but the beginning of something new. Bob has entered into this great mystery that is death and new life, a time of sacred endings and beginnings. Sacred endings and beginnings are part of the great circle of life itself. They are visible all around us in this wonderful world. The nesting ducks and geese are back in Saskatchewan. I was out walking the other day along the drainage ditch near the church. Not that glamorous, I know, but it's a place where there are families of ducks that return each year and lay their eggs. Soon, the chicks will be ready to peck their way out of the shells. Their life in the shell of what was their known world will come to an end. And they, once they, you know, the shell kind of gets softer and it gets lighter, and then they start to peck their way through. And they, when that shell breaks open, they will enter into a world that they never knew existed and begin the next part of their lives. And they will be able to spread their wings and fly. Leaves are also starting to bud on the tree branches. They will leaf out, and then eventually they will fall to the ground. They will die and become food for organisms that in turn enrich the soil. The life of the leaf must end so that the organisms can live. We here and online are now in our time of endings and beginnings too. When someone dies, it can be a bittersweet time. We want them back, yet we don't want them back to suffer. Know that you are not alone on this journey of grief. Love's power is with you. It is within you and the people that journey with you. All love comes from God, and God is love. God is with you. There can be times in our life when we ask the question, why? Why do things happen the way they do? Why was there so much suffering? And especially in these pandemic times, life's losses can be overwhelming. And Bob struggled too with the question why at times, and so did the Apostle Paul when he wrote in 1 Corinthians, and here is his response. For now we see in a mirror dimly, then we shall see face to face. Now I know only in part, and then I will know fully, even as I have been fully known. In other words, we just don't know why. It's not clear. There are no answers. It is a mystery. The word enigma in Greek is all part of this. It's part of a sacred, deep mystery when it comes to the big picture of life. And in this pandemic times, it is a time of worry and fear and anger, and it's important to name our feelings in this time. We are also invited to channel our anger and worry into acts of unconditional love, into acts of kindness and care. We are invited to be open to the mystery and the blessing amidst this struggle in this time. And what is the blessing in all of this? Amidst this time of struggle, there are friendships, love, surprising acts of kindness. There is the beauty of the earth, the glory of the skies, the colors of the rainbow, so pretty in the sky, are also on the faces of people going by. This is a blessed and wonderful world. Bob is gone from among us, and Bob lives on. And one of the ways that we live on is through the things that we teach others. I asked Carrie and Chris what their father taught them and what would be part of his legacy to them. And they talked about the golden rule growing up. Maybe you remember that too. A big part of their childhood, do unto others as you would have them do unto you. I got that one at home too. Family first, the value of an education. He struggled to provide at times and didn't want his children to have to struggle. Give a person a chance. Put your best foot forward, but stand up for yourself. He modeled respect to Joan. There are other things that each of us could add. Anybody want to add anything in the sanctuary? If you're watching online, type them in the comment box. Anything anybody else wanted to add that was kind of his legacy for you? Bob is gone. And he lives on. And now abides faith, hope, and love, these three. And the greatest of these is love. I invite you to open your hearts in prayer. O eternal presence, we gather this day in gratitude for Bob and his life and for the gift of life itself. We give thanks for the beauty of this day, for bright days and dark sacred nights and the beauty of this earth. And we give thanks for the love that he knew and the love he shared and all the good that lived on from who he was. We hold in prayer all who knew and loved him today, family, extended family, friends. We hold Joan in prayer today that she would know love and support, and that she would find beauty, friendship, and care in community at Life at Pioneer. We hold Bob's family in prayer, his grandchildren and great-granddaughter. And today we name Chris and Lee, Carrie and Heather, Kirby and Grace, Ken and Marcy. It's been an emotionally challenging time, and we send our loving prayers to you. May you and we be guided by who he was and will continue to be for us. We hold the staff at Pioneer in prayer today. We pray for wisdom and compassion and strength as they care for persons who have dementia. And for all the staff and all the residents at Pioneer. We hold in prayer all who are struggling in this time of pandemic, frontline workers of all kinds, for people cut off from community, for people waiting for surgery, for all struggling with loneliness. Strengthen us, guide us in ways of safety and support. Help us to discover the beauty and love that is always with us. Help us to be channels of love this day. I invite us now to take time in silence, to meditate, to pray, to reflect. And after our time of silence, Dawn will be singing the Lord's Prayer. Let us have a time of silence. And so we pray as we sing. I invite you to stand as you are able. Members of the Christian communities in the early church were called the community of saints. They weren't saints like mystical figures, just regular people who lived faithful lives. And so we commend Bob, here departed, into God's eternal love. We give thanks that he is among the saints in light. Amen. Please be seated. And so, our final hymn, Amazing Grace. So friends, go now in peace. May you know the love of God that abides in you and surrounds you each day and in every way. Bob and Joan promised each other long ago that they would have the song "The Party's Over" played at their memorial services. So Brian, our trumpeter, will play this, and then he's going to shift into "When the Saints Go Marching In." So you're invited after the party's over to stand and to move along around us, whatever way you want, as we celebrate Bob to the music this day.
Go in peace this day. Amen.